We have two things to do now, and the one is, of course, you're supposed to get some time to try and figure out some of these problems. So you're invited to try. There's scissors around, there's pens around. You can try on these problems. And on the other hand, I'm happy to collect comments and questions and ideas around my presentations. Yes.
What is the prevalence of the idea for a proof or theorem in the shower? From my anecdotal collection of self-reported inspirations in other contexts, that seems to have the highest prevalence.
I definitely believe that as well. And for me, under the shower is a wonderful place to think. The hot water bill at home is rather high. But sort of for making this collection, I'm sort of looking for proof, which means that for really quoting this, I would like, you know, diaries or even papers of mathematicians where they say, you know, thanks to my hot water pill and my shower at home where I had the main idea for this paper. And I don't think that that's published anywhere. If you know a source, I'd love to know. Yes. You can take that down.
Well, does every math problem like have to have a proof to it?
Whether it has to have a proof to it?
Does every math problem have to have a proof to it?
That's a very good question. Whether every problem has a proof to it, and the answer, as we know now, is no. And so there's various ways to state that. So, I mean, of course, that's an awful thing to say, that some math problems just don't have a solution. And that's a discovery mainly due to Kurt Gödel. It's an Austrian mathematician who then came to the States in the 1930s. And in order to show that there's problems which are perhaps true but definitely don't have a proof, you have to, of course, have a very formal idea what it means to have a proof. And that's what he did. And then he gave an argument which shows that there is things that cannot be proven. So that's so there is a proof to the fact that some problems don't have a proof. But that's completely... That's a difficult and interesting statement.
My question is about the places. You have your memories of the places where proofs occur and your imagination of where they might have occurred. I'm wondering if you have thought about places that would be particularly conducive to creating proofs that maybe don't exist, but like you wish it would be like that, it would be more conducive. This is an architectural question.
There's one place that I definitely should mention, and it's sort of connected to the coffee machine, which is that a wonderful place for doing mathematics is at a coffee shop or at a cafe. And actually, there's a colleague in Tel Aviv, Israel, a mathematical economist, who has started to collect a website where in many cities around the world, he lists cafes that have been tested to be excellent as places where you can not only have coffee, but really sit and think and do mathematics. And you can look this up on the internet as sort of a list of recommended cafes and tested cafes for doing math. And I can tell you a bunch of them are in New York City.
Thank you. So one would say that the Museum of Mathematics will be a place to try to come up with a new solution. So can I pose a question, a problem to you and to everybody?
Yes.
We call this, let's call it the Singapore entrance, kindergarten entrance exam problem. So you have to be able to solve this problem to get into the advanced kindergarten in Singapore.
Okay.
Right? You're on
I
one
will
si-
just pass this on to all of you. Don't worry.
You're on one side of a river with four boats, A small boat takes 1 minute to go across. A little bigger boat takes 2 minutes, and another boat 4 minutes, and the biggest boat takes 8 minutes. And the rules of the game are you can't swim, you can't throw anything, you're a single person. You can either take one boat across at a time or two boats across at a time or back by putting a smaller boat into a bigger boat, like putting the 1 minute boat in the 2 minute boat. You can go across in 2 minutes and then come back with the 1 minute boat. Those are all the rules. What's the minimum time to get all four boats to the other side? And can you prove it?
I think I definitely won't prove that here on the spot. It sounds like a very good problem, so I think everybody can think about
think
it
about
and
it.
Thus prepare for kindergarten.
Yes.
I might not be ready for that yet. The other problem I'm facing there is something that I tried to tell you earlier, which is math shouldn't be done in public. And an addendum to that is to do math is even harder if you're sort of in front of the blackboard or on stage.
On stage. And
so I'm not trying to play the math whiz there.
Okay, so think about that problem, and then you too can get into advanced kindergarten in Singapore or Korea or Japan or Taiwan.
Looking forward to that. Thanks. Next question here.
Well, this is kind of a weird question, but I was in the bathroom, and there's like domino tiles that looked like domino tiles, but they were like of two. And I wonder if there's proof for finding that, because I think there might be too many to count.
Okay. I mean, I assume that in the bathroom there's only finitely many tiles, and someone fixed them to the wall, so they are all there. But there's two very good observations in what you say. One is you should keep your eyes open. And you will see actually very nice and interesting tilings, and not only this boring chessboard thing, all over the place, for example, in various bathroom tiles. And so the one thing is to keep your eyes open. And the second is that you can always use them to devise interesting new problems, right? Of course, to make this somehow a putting together or tiling or domino problem, usually you just take a finite board of some shape, and then you put some rules, and this could be dominoes or triminoes or whatever. You usually prescribe what you should put together, and then next problem is done. So rather than solving problems, you can also start and designing problems, and that's also a fun job to do. Thank you. Next question.
Hi. In the beginning, you mentioned the dichotomy of the different types of proofs. Simple to complicated, elegant.
Yeah.
When you select proofs for your book, different problems that you put in, which ones appeal to you the most, and what's that process like?
Yeah, that's a complicated question. So for this book that Martin Eigler and I were doing, sort of one prerequisite was that it shouldn't be too complicated and too technical. So of course, if you study math and somehow pile one math book on top of the other, then things get arbitrarily complicated. We said everything that goes into that book should be doable with sort of first semester college mathematics. But the more important thing is, so we were collecting things where we said that this is sort of book proofs. And we did not start and define what we mean by a book proof. But so a book proof should be elegant. It should have some moment of surprise in it. It should make an interesting connection between things that perhaps one didn't see immediately. But that's all sort of elements of interesting proofs. There's no good definition, and there's no complete answer, definitely.
What's the most unusual place where you've made a mathematical discovery? Or perhaps somebody you know?
Good question. Actually, you know, with most things, somehow, at some point, I won't know anymore. But so the ones I would remember, I think I've not made discoveries in two unusual places, perhaps. But I remember one key idea and observation, which was in the airport lounge in Munich, where my advisor, Anders Björner, was ready to fly back to Stockholm. And we were still talking the last 15 minutes and scribbling on a napkin there in this cafeteria. And it was a key observation, which in the end published in a paper of the Journal of the American Mathematical Society, which is very prestigious, and I think it's a paper I'm very proud of. And part of that paper is that Anders nearly missed the plane. And I still have this paper napkin with the basic idea in drawing on this paper napkin. So one of the corollaries of that is that these good cafes that are good to think in, they all have paper napkins and not linen cloth, and they all have waiters or waitresses who, if needed, will supply a pen if you forget to bring that and if you suddenly have an idea. But that's at least one of them.
I have my personal favorite of a place where mathematics was done.
Okay.
Partially because it's the ultimate example of a person working in privacy to create a theorem, in this case, for 7 years. And also because the theorem he created is possibly the most complicated one ever done. I'm talking about the Fermat's Last Theorem and Andrew Wiles working in his attic himself to do that, what I think is a 200-page theorem.
Yeah, no, that's definitely true. And so I wrote a book which came out in German 2 years ago and which will right now be translated into English. English translation will be called Do I Count? Stories from Mathematics. And this has one chapter on these places where math is done. And this desk in the attic of this house in Princeton where Andrew Wiles was working is one of the places that I talk about there. So the story is, I had this slide about Fermat's Last Theorem and this 350-year story, and there's the last 7 years of these 350, so to speak, is Andrew Wiles working alone in his attic, and then in the last stage, together with his former student, Richard Taylor, proving Fermat's Last Theorem. So I think we should just take the last question because time is running out.
Hi, thank you. Wanted to thank you for an interesting presentation. I'm very taken by the number of young men and women who are attending this talk of yours, and I think it's quite impressive. And I'm wondering, when did you see in yourself that you had this interest and aptitude, and how did you cultivate that? And maybe you could speak to the young men and women that are here. I think that's very interesting.
I think I realized this perhaps much later than others. So there's these stories when I was not even in elementary school yet, where apparently I was interested and good at playing with numbers. Actually, it turned out that that's not my greatest talent, and I'm not somehow a computing whiz or so. But like my mother always had good confidence in my talent. So this was when I was supposed to somehow jump from second to fourth grade and to be a bit faster than other kids at the time. They asked me to do a math test with fourth grade problems. And I somehow did rather poorly on that, whereas the German test and these things were okay. And so they talked to my mother about that, and she told them they shouldn't worry about my math talents. And things like multiplication and division of large numbers, she then showed me this afternoon before I switched to fourth grade. But I think I developed my talent for math as a high school kid with doing competitions. And that's one way going into math, and I think a lot of the math I learned was from year after year, actually 5 years in a row, trying to compete in the German Federal Math Competition, which is a take-home thing. And so I spent a lot of time in these problems, and I was not very good at that at the beginning. And sort of my problem-solving skills are not something that somehow come from the fact that my brain is wired better than anybody else's, but they come from these years of training and having fun and concentrate on problems and playing around with them and going sort of backdoor alleys with some thoughts and seeing things that don't work out. And I think that just means I have a lot of experience in trying out ideas that don't work. And that's an experience that turns out to be very valuable and has to be cultivated. So that's perhaps how I would describe it.
Thank you.
So perhaps on the problems, in principle, I would have some solutions on my sort of after the last slide here that I could show you, but somehow I don't want to spoil your fun. Perhaps you might also want to take some of them home. There is solution sheets to take away and take home if you want. But if you want to play with this a bit more, it's completely clear that some of these can't be done in 5 minutes. Take your time, have fun with it, and I think that's what I would suggest on my part. So that's the end of my presentation. Thanks a lot.